Transition care, whatever they call it.
Check. 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 Check.
Thank you. Yeah, we got enough time to do warm-ups.
Thank you.
the warm-up. I haven't played for a while. I didn't take my banjo to California.
When did you go to California?
Last week.
And you're back?
Yeah, only went for a week.
A whirlwind
big
tour?
Big party.
Rather dangerous weapon today.
There are angels looking over us, whether or not we want to admit it. I guarantee you.
Why do you say that?
Because left to our own devices, it's mayhem and chaos.
It's my favorite all-time song.
That one?
Good morning.
That's an easy one.
What's that? No, I just took it off. I'm gonna be.
You usually have it around your neck.
No, I never do that. Very good.
Yeah. Excellent.
Very good. Coming home on Tuesday.
Oh, wonderful.
That's good news.
Okay.
How about if I move over here?
Oh, no problem.
I'm going to move over. Yeah.
It was written by Lionel Tonzi, who was the song leader before Congress.
Yes.
Really?
Along with John.
Was that regarding when they had the power line things up north? Was this regarding the power line issue? Okay, because I remember that. Got it.
Yeah, well, it was almost 50 years ago.
Except PFC.
A lifetime. I'll follow along. Get my kazoo out for any appropriate songs that might arise.
Do you have something in mind? 50.
So your plants must look great. Your plants must look great.
Yeah,
I'll be Julie Bard.
Why don't you grab that mic there? Well, just bring the whole thing.
Yeah.
Tony, you're standing on the line.
No.
Sorry.
Yeah, that's too. Yeah, okay.
There you go. Now you're rocking.
The big band today.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to do number 50, 50. Don't hear it very much often here, but Lorenzo Lattenzi was a great singer, and he was a song leader here in the early days of Back to Church at Walker. Steel gray afternoon. Feels like a feature-length cartoon. This train stopped dead in its tracks.
I'm talking to myself, 'cause there's nobody else. I'm gone again and I won't look back.
Listen to me, heart. We're all so far apart.
I just want to get closer to you. When this train is moving, things just keep improving. I just want to sing a song or two about these power lines across the prairies.
Hey,
hey, bells in the rain.
Fields that stretch forever. Fence posts across the plains. Me and another clown went drinking in a Midwestern town. Paid $2 for each beer. 'Cause up there in the spotlight, there's a lady and she looks all right. Singing the songs we want to hear. Number 15. And in a floor-length gown, she's just another clown. Singing love songs for someone. She dreams of movie stars sitting alone at the bar. I wonder if she really has anyone out here like power lines across the prairie. I wish someone could just show me a break in the seal, gray sky. Mountains just don't exist when you're crawling through the mist. You could easily but the bar car is open. There's words left to be spoken, and silence to be broken up with a song. And somewhere in the distance, I know there must be mountains. This train keeps rolling right on along. Out here like power lines across the prairies. Hey, bells in plains. Fields that stretch forever. A fence goes across the plain.
Oh, is that ever beautiful? What a beautiful song. God, that's great. Oh. Never heard that before. That's just wonderful.
Request, please.
Wonder 107.
I think I heard that.
Yep. I saw the light. Perky, upbeat.
All right, the gospel according to St. Hank.
You got it.
I saw the light.
I saw the light.
No more darkness,
no more night.
Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light. Well, I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I couldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like an angel in the night.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
Lord,
I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and tears I claimed for my own. Then like a blind man, that God gave back his sight.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
I was a fool to wander astray, frustrated is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right.
Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
I saw the light. I saw the light.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light. I saw the light,
I saw the light.
No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light.
Request.
98.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I own this song.
This one we know really well. This is a good harmonica song. Yeah.
Tony, I'm better.
Yeah, definitely. City, the Lord, and it's not, oh no, it's
That'll get your feet moving.
Oh, yeah. Page? 88.
Oh, boy. This is all gospel music all the time.
Oh, yeah.
Well.
Hey, I'll fly away.
Let's rip this thing. Oh, yeah.
Going to wear out the old man here.
Good kazoo song. You're right.
Yeah. Well, we always end these with what's called Big Church.
Before you go
to the fourth quarter. You can tune a piano, but you can't tune a fish. Jimmy Buffett.
Some glad morning, when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. By and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away. Fly away, oh glory, fly away. In the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. By and by, I'll fly away.
Fly away, oh glory,
I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by,
supplement. You got it. In the
number five.
This one's for Helen. This one's for Helen.
Donna. She said, I think it was in the supplement. She wanted. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, I guess we'll do it. B minor.
Trying to remember how it goes.
B minor.
A long time.
Okay. on a wagon bound for market. There's a cat with a mournful eye. High above him, there's a swallow flying freely through the sky. How the winds are laughing, they laugh with all their might. Laugh and laugh the whole day through, and half the summer, the night. Dona, 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 dona. Dona, 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 dona. Stop complaining, says the farmer. Who told you a calf to be? Why don't you have wings to fly with? Like the swallow, so proud and free. How the winds are laughing, they laugh with all their might. Laugh and laugh the whole day through, and half the summer, the night. Dona, 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 dona. Dona, 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 dona. Calves are easily bound and slaughtered, never knowing the reason why. But whoever treasures freedom, like the swallow, has learned to fly. How the winds are laughing, they laugh with all their might. Laugh and laugh the whole day through, and half the summer's night. Dona, 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 dona.
All right, we got the preacher calling one out.
Country Roads.
We already practiced this. 37.
Country Roads, 37. We're filling up with
37.
People.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountain, growing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home. I belong, West Virginia, Mountain Mama, take me home, country roads. All my memories gathered around her, miner's lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky, misty taste of moonshine, teardrop in my eye. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, Mountain Mama, take me home.
I hear her voice in the morning hour. She calls me. Radio reminds me of my home far away. Driving down the road, I get a feeling that I should have been home yesterday. Yesterday, country roads take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, mountain mama, take me home. Down country roads, take me home. Down country roads.
One more.
All right.
Uno mas. Who's got one?
We're never always prepared.
The crickets are cool.
For the unexpected.
You have to check that. 153.
All right.
A Zoomer chimes in. Oh, Brett's dazzling
bouquet. Jambalaya and a crawfish pie, too.
Mine is a church where everybody's welcome. And I know it's true, cause I got through the door. We are a dazzling bouquet of every kind of flower. Jump in the vase, cause we got space for more. Come here, all you 6 foot gladiolas. Come all you purple lilacs shining bright. Come and let us all bloom together in one garden. A carnival of a fragrant sandy line. Yeah, mine is a church where everybody's welcome. And I know it's true, cause I got through the door. We are a dazzling bouquet of every kind of flower. Jump in the vase, cause we got space for more. And we don't simply tolerate each other. We ask and tell, we don't just turn away. We give attention to every bud and blossom. Let every face come to grace the grand bouquet. I said, mine is a church where everybody's welcome. And I know it's true, cause I got through the door. We are a dazzling bouquet of every kind of flower. Jump in the vase, cause we got space for more.
Kent Horowitz.
And our demons keep trying to divide us. And they document their lies, but they ain't true. Today we're freed from our judging and excluding. Just look around, enjoy the lovely view. Yeah, mine is a church where everybody's welcome. And I know it's true, cause I got through the door. We are a dazzling bouquet of every kind of flower. Jump in the race, cause we got space for more. Jump in the vase, cause we got space and more. Welcome to Walker Church, where our mission is to nurture spirituality, build caring community, and work courageously for peace, justice, and mercy. Blessed be.
Be here now. Be here now. Be here now. Be thank you.
Well, I was very tempted to go with one of the two favorite Lao Tzu verses, but I think we've heard enough for a while, maybe. So, from verse 16 of the Widdowbinner translation, "Be utterly humble, and you shall hold to the foundation of peace. Be at one with all these living things which, having arisen and flourished, return to the quiet whence they came, like the healthy growth of vegetation falling back to the root. Acceptance of this return to the root has been called quietism. Acceptance of quietism has been condemned as fatalism, but fatalism is acceptance of destiny. And to accept destiny is to face life with open eyes, whereas not to accept destiny is to face death blindfold. One who is open-eyed is open-minded. One who is open-minded is open-hearted. One who is open-hearted is kingly. One who is kingly is godly. One who is godly is useful. One who is useful is infinite. One who is infinite is immune, and one who is immune is immortal." In 5 minutes.
find it now.
You dropped something on the floor. That's not it.
Yeah, that doesn't help though. Well, good, I found it.
So this is an excerpt from an essay by Cicero entitled Of Death and Old Age, and seems to be written to me to his close friends and family. I would not, my children, that you should think, when I am departed out of this life and gone from you, that I shall be nowhere or brought to nothing. My mind shall remain as before, although you see it not visibly. Every good and wise man dieth willingly and rejoiceth therein exceedingly, taking death to be a joyful messenger to summon him to endless felicity. I have a great desire to see and behold your fathers and mothers, who I entirely loved and had for their singular virtue great admiration. And when I am in my journey to them, which I so greatly desire, there should be no person bring me back again, though they would and also could, neither to make me to retire to the place from whence I came, like to a ball which tennis players toss and strike to their counter players, and they again to the other side. Yea, though they would undertake to renew my youth again, I will say more. If God would grant me now in this age to return again to my infancy and to be as young as a child that lieth crying in their cradle, I would refuse and forsake the offer with all my might. Neither would I, when I have already in a manner run the whole race and won the goal, be again revoked from the end, marked to the lists, or place where I took my course at the first setting out. I depart out of this life as out of an inn, and not out of a dwelling house. For nature hath given to us a lodging to remain and sojourn in for a time, and not to dwell in continually. O lucky and blessed day wherein I shall take my journey to appear before the blissful troop in convocation of happy minds, and leave this troublesome world, being the veil of all misery and the filthy sink of all mischief. For I shall not only go to those worthy people, but also to my dear son Cato, who is a man of such sanctity and goodness as none before.
We'll have some announcements. While we're announcing, we'll also have some offering taken. What's your question? When's the next planning meeting? You mean the next Faithful Path? Yeah, it's this Thursday. Yep, 7 p.m. this Thursday, the 25th. It's the conclusion. Conclusion meeting, and then on the 11th we'll have our charge conference after the service, the 11th of September. Okay, today we're having People's Climate and Equity Plan presentation. Bonnie, did you want to say anything about that? Okay, she just hopes everyone comes, stays for that. We have there's food right out here, and all right, let's see. Next Sunday, Deb Ramage is speaking. Thank you, Deb. And Jim Kantorowicz will be playing some music for us. And the first Sunday in September, Kay Seelhoff has agreed to speak for us, so that'll be interesting. And then on the 11th, it will be Reverend David Wheeler before our charge conference, and we have decided on some dates for an apocalypse cafe. You'll hear more about that. That'll be in October. The four Sundays in October, the Apocalypse Cafe. I'm sorry, I forgot to take it off the mask. Okay, any other announcements?
Okay, board announcements, summary of the board meeting. We met yesterday. And, okay, kind of odds and ends and miscellaneous things here. It is likely that the lead of our weekly food distro will shift from Andy to Carmen from Sisters Camelot, so that we have a lead who is fluent in both English and Spanish. Because of this shift, the food distro may move to Mondays at noon. If that does become the case, we will be communicating that broadly. We also want to bring to your attention that Mary Buckley, who is right over there, I think everybody knows Mary, will be leading a one-time membership class. This is important because church membership is required to vote at the charge conference on September 11, which is a conference when we finalize the decisions discussed over the past several weeks. Again, if you want to vote in the charge conference, you must complete your membership before September 11th. Talk to Howard if you'd like to participate, and Howard, everybody knows, is sitting right over there waving his arm. Also, talk to Howard if you would like to receive the e-newsletter. If you signed up to receive the newsletter but have not received one later, also talk to Howard. Thank you.
Mary, do you have an announcement?
I have a kind of a clarification, because there's different vases here. About the Apocalypse Cafe is a four-session way for us to talk about things that are hard to name or talk about when you have that what's happening to the world feeling and what's going on. And the apocalypse is kind of like in a basic meaning is kind of a coming of a head and change of everything. It will not be Bible-based on biblical apocalyptic stuff. I mean, people could bring up their thoughts, but it's going to be group-led based on the things that people bring up. And refreshments will be provided.
Right. Right. It's going to be here in the sanctuary. And during October, it'll be Monday evenings in October. And if we want to continue on past October, then we can do that. So,
I just wondered if anybody could just give a brief wrap up of the meeting this past Thursday. It was Thursday, right? Because I was not able to get there, and just I thought perhaps the congregation might want to know just like a brief kind of takeaway for those that didn't make it. Anybody? It's which newsletter?
In the email. Newsletter.
When did that come out? When did the?
Friday.
It was out Friday. Okay. I'll look at that. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Other announcements. All right, then let's hear from Henry.
The button. Oh, we're good. Yeah, that makes sense. I feel like I can count on like one hand the number of times my full face has been exposed in this room. All right, I'm also stealing this from Mary Buckley, did her little sermon from down here, and I thought that was pretty spiffy, so I figured I'd feel a little less nervous. All right, this the scripture that I picked out to read is my number one favorite Bible verse of all time, so one would think I'd have it memorized, but I'll read it off the paper. It's Psalm 118, verse 22. For folks who track on this kind of thing, it's a like uncredited Psalm of King David. The Psalm reads, "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." And somehow along the way for myself, that was kind of retranslated as the way I remember it is the building block that was rejected will become the cornerstone of a whole new world. So, all right, I thought I'd lead off with a Mark Twain quote. This is from a notebook that they found of his that he said, if Christ were alive today, he would not be Christian. And that's like, yeah, that when I thought of that quote, I was like, this would be a pretty good hook for a sermon. And in my home church, that definitely would have been a big old hook. But here at Walker, I imagine there's a number of people in this room who are already very on board with Mark Twain's feelings about that. And for a little bit of background, I was raised very mainline Presbyterian. To borrow a Phil Oakes quote, I would say that my home church was 10 degrees to the left of center in good times and 10 degrees to the right of center if it affected them personally. And that's always been, that was kind of the world I grew up in, and kind of in alignment with their personal liberalism, they would turn to the Bible to answer their big political questions of the day. So issues like nuclear weapons, clinical abortion, Israeli occupation of Palestine, let's ask this 2,000-year-old book what we should do. And they naturally didn't find exactly very clear-cut answers in there, but especially in the Presbyterian church I grew up in, it led to a lot of really intense theological discourse and lots of specifically like biblically grounded theological discourse. And around the time that I was going through confirmation in middle school, the big question of the day was whether the Presbyterian church should affirm queer and gay relationships, which that was the big hot topic at church, which coincidentally was also the big hot topic in my brain at the time, because I was beginning to have a crush on my friend Mason DeLutri. And I was just thinking about that all the time, and it was just a huge, huge question, and it was really interesting to be in a space where people were so focused on what the Bible had to say about that, even beyond, almost they weren't even concerned about the morality of the question, they could be swayed by what the Bible said. And so, flash forward to my sophomore year in high school, which turned out to be a very big year for me for a few different reasons. That year, toward the start of the year, I had emergency brain surgery, which very thankfully these brilliant doctors were able to keep me alive, and I'm still walking around, partly cyborg to this day. And that experience kind of made me like, okay, I gotta figure out this gay thing should come out. And so I did, it came out that year. And then around that same time, that same year in 2014 is when the Presbyterian Church General Assembly voted to begin formally affirming queer relationships. In the same year, a book that was very big to me in my faith at the time came out by this author, Matthew Vines. He wrote a book called God and the Gay Christian, if anyone's ever heard of this book. It was big to me at the time because he was like this very cute, young, Harvard, whatever, divinity school theologian who wrote a book essentially going through each verse that's cited as justification for homophobia and explaining how there's no biblical foundation for homophobia, which is something that I think folks in this room are very on board with. But for me at the time, I was like, whoa, that's really earth-shattering. That's, you know, like to realize that this issue that there had been kind of clear consensus and then suddenly there wasn't, and now we're fully doing a U-turn on this thing in your religion, you know, this thing that you had been told this is the truth, and now you're realizing that, oh, someone sort of made this up to justify hurting people. And that was kind of the first moment, that, yeah, realizing there's flimsy biblical grounding for homophobia. was really challenging for me, and it brought this question of where did that start? Why would that, why would folks do that? And kind of as I was digging into that is where I first came to, I think this naturally makes sense, I first became very skeptical of organized religion, realizing that a bunch of people can get together and to find more power, they want to scapegoat a group of people, or they want to put people down, and they'll use whatever means they have, the Bible, other things, to try and justify their actions. And that really got me concerned about organized religion, but I was also reading this book by Matthew Vines. I was like, well, maybe there's like a way that Orthodox Christianity can be, you know, in partnership with open sexuality and things like this. But at any rate, up until that point in my life, the most intense experiences I had had with organized religion were always at this Jesus camp that I've mentioned here once before. I went to like, my church was fairly centrist. And this camp was like evangelical Presbyterianism. It was full on, this is not PCUSA, this is PCA, if anyone knows about that. But yeah, it was really intensely homophobic and a lot of other things, but I loved going to camp because it's camp and you're a kid. And I would try to go there all the time as a kid. I would spend as much of my summer there as I could. And then that became really hard in high school as I kind of struggled more and more with how do I fit in there. And my family had a tradition of being on staff at that summer camp after high school. Everyone, my mom, starting with my mom, folks had been on staff there. So I applied and they said that they couldn't hire me because I was out, but they could hire me as an independent contractor. Because I made good movies. I was the media person. So I was there, but I had to, the agreement was that I would be fully in the closet. I wasn't supposed to tell any of my co-counselors, and I was definitely not ever supposed to talk to kids about that. And through the summer, I never was out with any campers, but I did end up coming out to my coworkers because it's just, you're living with people for a whole summer and you get really close. And fortunately for me, the folks that I did come out to were incredibly supportive and very angry on my behalf about the rules there. And that campus since kind of had a reform, but at any rate, I spent that summer after high school working at this Jesus camp back in the closet, and while I was there is kind of when it was really cemented to me that religion, separate from spirituality, religion can be about this power dynamic that people want to, especially watching like the indoctrination of kids. I don't know if people in this room have been in that experience as a kid or have worked around children who are being indoctrinated in a faith, but it is alarming. If you're any degree of like cognitive dissonance, like cognitive separation from what's going on, it can be a really freaky thing to watch. And that's when I think I had a big waking up moment about organized religion. Then I got to thinking, well, there's a pretty flimsy biblical grounding for organized religion, similar to this, not a lot of grounding for homophobia. And the way I arrived at that is that summer while I was there, the Bible verse that really was just on loop in my head was this, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And if anyone's familiar with the New Testament, Jesus cites that in the parable of the tenants, which is kind of a complicated parable. I don't like it that much. But the parable of the tenants, he says the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And in that case, he's naming the builders is kind of the organized religion of the day, very interested in dividing up the people in an effort to control them. And he is sort of this cornerstone that's building a whole new world. And as a queer Christian at the summer camp, it was kind of, I just felt very rejected by the faith. And it was really empowering to know that's just, there's just this history in the church of the stone that's rejected becomes the cornerstone of a whole new world. But so, Jesus has this problem with organized religion. He calls it out a lot in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, there's also call outs of organized religion as potentially dubious. And so then this question, why do we have organized religion? And then I was like, that's impossible to answer. I was like, LOL, IDK. But do people want power? But the big thing that I've experienced in that is that, especially for folks of my generation, it's you're really not alone in this question. There's a lot of people similar to me who kind of were pretty on board with the church thing, and then just asking one question about homophobia led to the realization that the whole church's obsession with power is very antithetical to the teachings that it purports to be about. And a lot of folks my generation and age use the phrase deconstructing as like a term that you've maybe heard from young people. But that's a phrase for kids who were really bought in and then really bought out. I don't know. They left the church for very theological reasons. So I didn't attend church regularly for a lot of years, really until I walked into Walker Church. Walker Church is the first faith community that I felt I could hang out in. And so what attracted me to Walker Church? And this is a question I get a lot from Walkerites, is why are you here? And for me, it was, I think, a lot about that very first Sunday that I was here. I remember Al getting up here doing the directions, and it was like, I was sitting toward the back, and I remember Al running up from doing the sound to go to the directions, and then going back and setting an alarm on his phone for the chime, and then the chime goes off, and then like 3 seconds later, the alarm on his phone audibly goes off, and he's a little bit flustered. And I remember that experience and just thinking like, this is disorganized religion. And it was an incredibly, just beautiful thing to see people, and everyone was just really, nobody was like upset about like, oh, what? Like, this is church, come on. And it's just been an incredibly like liberating experience for me to be in a space where there's no huge bar for how you engage with your faith. Let's see, what did I learn at Walker? I have written down here, I learned that religion is politics and politics is religion. I think that's something that's been really exciting about Walker for me, is how forward everyone is with their politics and willing to talk about it and kind of really muddy this space between spirituality and politics and religion. And there's not this dichotomy of like earthly things, spiritual things, they don't mix, whatever. And there's also not just this opposition to the material reality that we live in. And I think that that really resonates for me because it, and this is a conversation I've had with housemates and other folks, but we're living in this, an age of disorganized religion. Living in this moment where people can't pretend that there's a separation between politics and religion because you can't even see a separation. Some people's politics really look like a religion, and some people's religions really look like their politics. And as we kind of are, this is going to be kind of Apocalypse Cafe stuff for a second. As we live in this moment where public institutions lose control, climate becomes unpredictable, we're kind of increasingly living, at least myself, what I've witnessed is living out sort of a faith-based politics, where even my politics, which is supposed to be like, I read a bunch of stuff, figure out what is the right way to do things, even that is, the stuff that I do is kind of hoping that it works, like having faith that this is what's gonna work out. It's not necessarily always grounded in absolute science. One thing I have down here is, I think, something I've struggled with is kind of there's these rituals that I've adopted that make me feel safe. And a great example of this for me is this like inconsistent masking, where sometimes I'll put on a mask to talk to the person that I'm getting an order from at the restaurant, and then as soon as I sit down, I take off my mask and I'm just sitting there. Everyone else in the room has their masks off, but then I'm putting on our masks for kind of this ritualistic for show. And I often like, wow, should I actually just be doing way more consistent masking? What does it say about me that that's kind of, I'm just doing this for safety? But I think that the most clear-cut example of this phenomenon of kind of politics and religion becoming so intertwined and confused is this moment where kind of this cult of individuality that we live in the United States especially, that through this cult of individuality, capitalism is becoming a very, it's effectively a dominant religion in the United States at this point. People, they say, like, if you hustle and sweat and serve the markets, they will reward you. And it's just very faith-based. People do things because they are told that if we work hard, good things are going to happen. Very much like prosperity theology. Those two things are so interwoven. And it only very occasionally works for people. If they work really hard, that things go well for them. But we tell them to have faith. And so this is kind of the point of what I wanted to talk about, which now I'm going to be opening up to talk back in a second, but what do we do about that? You know, how do you take down capitalism? Should we get organized? You know, organized religion, should we get organized? And I want to answer offer my answer to that question. It's not a fully baked answer. And then I want to open it up to talk back, because that's one of my all-time favorite things that Walker does. Or I should amend, I really like talk back when the speaker asks for talk back. If the speaker does not ask for talk back, this is my two cents, don't just start talking back at them. But yeah, so my answer to this question of what is there a role for organized religion in the revolution as it is, and in this collapse moment that we're kind of living through, or is there not a role, or what does organized religion look like, and what's called for? And my answer to this, just because I was raised in a very Bible-y house, I'm going to talk a tiny bit about Jesus. My answer is that Jesus argues that we don't, in the New Testament, Jesus argues that folks shouldn't be organizing against the Romans, but organizing for each other. And that's kind of his gospel of love and mercy and grace, that there's power to be had in helping each other. And there's a lot to lose in directly combating this imperialist dominant force of the world. And then on this point of organizing, right, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. I've always interpreted this as that if we want a liberated world, we cannot sort people into those that are on board with the revolution or those that agree with us and those that don't. Any society built on rejection and hierarchy it will collapse. And it's happening to the American church. I think it's a very direct consequence of the American church's decision to buy into homophobia as a concrete example, but on so many other issues, young people do a tiny bit of scrutiny on why does the church want to control this thing so much, and then that scrutiny leads to wanting to distance themselves from organized religion. And I think that this is a very natural consequence of the decision on the part of the American church and on the part of broader Western Christianity influences this idea of trying to exert control through exclusion. But that's my little spiel. That's my answer. And now I'd love to open up to talk back.
This was so rich, thank you. I'm really curious about prosperity theology, which I haven't heard that before, that capitalism is the current dominant religion in our society. And as far as, I wanted to make a comment too about something you said about working on behalf of all of us as opposed to working in opposition to the powers that be. I think they're both essential. It's a form of acquiescence to not say, no, you can't do that, whatever that is, like line three.
Yeah, I really appreciate that. That's definitely, I feel like, especially in a lot of practical ways, I definitely am always saying no to, or that's my gut reaction is to always be very much in the opposition, like trending toward opposition. And I think sometimes, interesting to just think about the strategic components of that and the strategic components of working for each other. On the topic of prosperity theology, I don't know the whole history of it. I feel like maybe some people were nodding who would know better histories of it, but I was associated with like televangelism, and it's a prosperity theology just says that if you have really good faith, you will be rewarded, which is based, my understanding is that theology is actually essentially based on capitalist thinking, that if you work hard, you pull yourself up by your bootstraps, you will get what you need. And so those are very, they've become very interwoven over the years. Not being ironic with the bootstrap impossibility. Yeah. Also, I was supposed to do special music, but I didn't pick a song, so we're just doing talk back instead of special
music.
Would
you like me to sing something? I you know, you put
Howard's got,
You've pushed a whole bunch of buttons for me today, but one of them that came out was, I think most people have a yearning to belong to some community or other. I mean, that's part of why I'm at Walker Church, is because it's a community where I can endure even when I have problems or disagreements. And I suspect that when you're talking about the power building thing, and that is that your desire to have community is exploited by people who are trying to lead you in their direction. That if you follow me, you'll belong to this group. If you take my orders, I'll give you the reward you have, and those other guys who are outside of our group aren't going to count. And of course, since I've been lucky enough to be raised as a white male in a rich country, I get a really easy welcome into community myself. And that's not very easy for a lot of people, which is why people join gangs, which is why people want to start. And I don't know, we'll never get this anarchy thing working unless we get organized.
Yeah. I like that line.
Thanks so much for your words, Henry. A lot of things to think about, like others have said. And you mentioned your portion of this that relates to your own personal like understanding of your sexuality and some of your personal history with that, Christianity and so have you thought too much? Have you ever thought much about how potentially Christianity doesn't do the best with sexuality, like in general? You know, not just for, you know, people that feel that they're homosexual or, you know, not straight heterosexual, but like just generally speaking, you know, there's a lot of rules for what's okay for like, you know, heterosexuals. And, you know, so perhaps, you know, it's kind of an area that has been oppressive for all people. And, you know, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a great point of just, I don't know, this is maybe not church appropriate, but I'm like, sex is this awesome free thing. No wonder the church wants to try to bottle it up and control it. Doesn't want people to have fun. But, yeah, no, I think that's a great point that the stuff on the church oppression of at least queer folks I know goes back to 500 AD. Is kind of the first time that they try to, that folks get a little panicky that they're losing control and try to scapegoat. And there's been so many iterations of what is allowed and what's not allowed. And like this, you know, guys kissing guys, totally normal. That's just what guys do. But anything more than that's wrong. So, no, I think that's a great, great point.
Yeah, well, that was a great sermon. You went so many different ways. You went deep into so many different subjects that I wouldn't even attempt to do any talk back, but it's just very interesting, and I hope, you know, that like the Apocalypse Cafe kind of thing where more people can get together and have talks about all of this.
Right, Jennifer.
I feel like I'm about to open up a big can of worms, maybe even a bucket, you know. But it's not just our churches. There's so much. There's a general awareness. I mean, the consciousness of our culture is going through this. It's not just in the church. It's basically everywhere. And whether you get the message, I mean, I remember like at a very young age, you know, we had a lot of freedom. I had a lot of gifts and things before I took to drinking and drugging and just burning a lot of bridges, because I just, my behavior had gone off into a deep abyss eventually. But I had so much freedom, you know, and I got to thinking, when I grew up, homosexuality or lesbianism, all these gay issues were virtually non-existent, mostly because they were always hushed under the carpet. And part of that from my own, you know, get me to think about, well, and then I heard at some point there was this point of juncture of where people were ACDC, meaning they had male-female relationships and then were bisexual as well. And it just threw me into a cataclysmic, you know, of conflict of interest, meaning, you know, where are my boundaries? I've researched this for myself. I have searched my soul so many times, you know, as to what my boundaries are. And I find it very difficult, just for personal reasons, to allow other people, you know, space, again, as far as keeping it under the, shoving it under the carpet. I mean, even in a role of leadership, though, that's not the wisest thing to do. But on a personal note, you know, I just try to give people as much space as they possibly can, you know, respect their boundaries and their personal interests. I don't always agree with them, but, you know, what? Who's to say who is really right, actually?
Thanks. Hello. Hi, everyone. My name is Nicola. Henry, loved what you had to say. I'm so with you. Oh, do I take off my mask?
Yes, take it off.
I'm so with you in this question of what is the role of organized religion. And I just wanted to share something that I heard about. One theory about why capitalism didn't take hold until the late 1700s was because even though the feudal lords at the time were trying to privatize property and were trying to organize a new economic system that back then didn't have a name but would become capitalism, the reason why their efforts weren't taking hold was because Catholicism was the prevailing religion at the time. And under Catholicism, any extra labor or any extra work one would put into their days had to be in service of another person. And greed was seen as evil. Greed was seen as punishable by God. And what I'm not trying to say is that we should all be Catholic. Please stay with me. But it wasn't until Protestantism started to shape the landscape, where all of a sudden there was this new idea where God would look kindly upon hard work and discipline and putting in extra labor. And all of a sudden there was this reason, there was this belief system that actually could allow some of the roots of capitalism to take hold. And I say this because I think it's really, it might be, it might help us see that like an economic system does depend on organized values to either take root or to not take root. And I love this question that Henry posed about what would an organized value system look like today that would actually be toxic to capitalism. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks, Nicola. Interesting. Nicola wasn't fully a plant. I do live with Nicola, but she didn't tell me she was going to say that.
Well, Henry, it was great to, is this thing, I guess, it's great to hear your story and your insights. It made me think about a lot of things, especially the organized part of religion. Because I'm like, yeah, I mean, I didn't go to church since I was 6 or 7. You know, I show up at Walker Methodist Church, right? Well, I came in because I read the website. You read Lao Tzu, you meditate. What? I got to go to this. And then, yeah. And then Walter gave a sermon, and then he's like, what do you guys think? I'm in. I'm coming back here. This is not what I thought was religion or a church. When I became a member, I said, I don't see this as a church. This is my spiritual community. And I'm thinking about that, what was it? Prosperity religion?
Yeah, right? Prosperity theology.
Theology. And I'm thinking, well, I was, I guess, a victim of prosperity, my own theology, thinking money was my God. And it just destroyed me. So what I came to understand, now I'm thinking, well, yeah, I worked real hard, but it didn't get me anywhere. But now I'm still working hard, but I'm working hard not on making money, I'm working hard on my spirituality. And that's given me gifts beyond my wildest dreams, things I never realized were even available to me. If I work on that, mm-hmm. and forget about the money. So I'm thinking about that a lot, what prosperity actually means. So thank you for bringing that up. Mm-hmm. And really looking forward to the Apocalypse Cafe, man.
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, I don't like money much.
We could just have one more last, really, really short.
Really short.
Because it's already time.
The sexuality and politics in early Christianity, or all throughout Christianity, and I think Judaism has a lot to do with misogyny and the hatred of or oppression of women or women's power or the feminine. It's just, there are parts in the Bible where it can be celebrated, like in Proverbs 8, with wisdom is a personification of a godly being. But yeah, that's where the crap is rooted.
All right. Thank you very much, Henry. This is great. Let's quickly get in a circle, and we'll have joys and concerns. And then Howard is going to lead us in number 51. So bring your songbook up, and we'll sing the cornerstone. So I know that we had a concern or a joy on Zoom, right?
Yeah, it's just an announcement from Nancy Larson to say that the women's brunch is Saturday, the 27th, at 10:30 at Christine Smith's house. And you can call Nancy Larson at her number, which is, this is going to be in the newsletter email also, so, but she wanted to announce that.
Okay, thank you. And we'll just go around here if you have a joy or a concern.
Welcome to my sister Anne, who's here from Boston. Her husband isn't here, but Anne is here with us. And my brother is coming in with his wife and son from Kiev. Well, my brother's from Kiev. He's unfortunately not right. Getting here. Otherwise, I was hoping he could come to church today. But so yeah, a lot of family here. So just want to celebrate that or happy about that.
The joy is that with all the rain, my garden has exploded, and the bees are going to be repollinating. They were working hard this morning, and my concern is that there may be vegetables left over, and I have to take them home. So please help yourself to the cucumbers and zucchini and summer squash.
You may recall that I asked people about coming to a pancake breakfast, which happened yesterday. And the joy is that it was a great success. A number of Walker people came, thank you very much. And my daughter and her friend Ray, who were the organizers, were delighted. They raised far more money than they expected to.
Well, this is a joy that arose from concerns. Becky Hansen is moving. And as of tomorrow, she will be in the Brookdale North Oaks residence in the memory care unit. You may recall that her daughter moved her to Iowa to be closer to her Becky's mother and family. Well, Becky's mother is gone, and Becky is, it's hard for Abby to move again and to put her mother in a home, but I think it's the right solution. And so it's called Brookdale North Oaks. You can Google it. North Oaks is a suburb of the Twin Cities. My plan is to go visit her there. Great.
Thank you. Thank you for letting us know that. Yeah.
A joy is that Henry walked through the door and that Al snagged him.
It's really great to be back here again. I've been gone for a long time. And just two small things, concern for my daughter who's lost her little dog that she's had for 10 years, and she just disappeared, and it's kind of heartbreaking. And the other concern is my dad is having dental surgery tomorrow, so just keep them in your thoughts.
Yeah, thank you.
Just a reminder, I ordered a lot of food from Holy Land. I hope you'll stay to help eat it and hear about the People's Climate and Equity Plan for Minneapolis.
All right. Huh? What?
A concern, there's a cat named Pepper whose person has moved into skilled care nursing, and Pepper has got a great disposition and is a good cat. Just kind of send that thought out into the community of your mind and heart that someone who needs a cat, an older cat, will connect with Pepper.
I'm sorry, there was one from Janet Skidmore. She has COVID and isn't feeling very well. If we want to put prayers toward that.
Okay, thank you. Was there somebody else that had a... Oh, okay. All right, how about birthdays? Did we have birthdays this week or coming up? Jesse? Yeah. What? And Jim? Jesse and Jim? Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jim and Jesse. Happy birthday to you.
Okay, as I said, this is number 51 in the book. Number 51 in the book, if you have a book.
Adonis, my strength and my song, who has become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. In my distress I called Adon. Adon answered and set me free. With Adon on my side I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? Adon is my strength and my song, who has become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. For our God lives in heaven. She does whatever she pleases. Either idols are made of silver and gold, the work of mortal hands. They have mouths, but they cannot speak. They have ears, but they do not hear. And those who make them are like them, and so are those who trust in them. Adon is my strength and my song, who has become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. For I am poor and needy, and my heart is stricken within me. I am gone like a shadow at evening. Like a locust, I am shaken off. My knees are weak from fasting. My body has become gaunt. I am an object of scorn to my accusers. When they see me, they shake their heads. Adon is my strength and my song, who had become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the day Adon has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad. This is the day Adon has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad. Adon is my strength and my song, who has become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. Oh, the cornerstone. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone.